In baptismal waters, our old life is washed away, and in them we are born anew. Glory to you for oceans and lakes, for rivers and streams. Honor to you for waters that wash us clean, quench our thirst, and nurture both crops and creatures. Praise to you for the life-giving water of baptism, the outpouring of the Spirit of the new creation. Wash away our sin and all that separate us from you. Empower our witness to your resurrection. Strengthen our resolve in seeking justice for all. Satisfy the world's need through this living water, where drought dries the earth, bring refreshment. Where despair prevails, grant hope. Where chaos reigns, bring peace. We ask this through Christ, who with you and the Spirit reigns forever.
Amen.
Thank you.
grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
And also with you.
Thank you. credit to you if, being aware of God, you endure pain while suffering unjustly. If you endure when you are beaten for doing wrong, what credit is that? But if you endure when you do right and suffer for it, you have God's approval. For to this you have been called, because Christ also suffered for you, leaving you an example so that you should follow in his steps. He committed no sin, and no deceit was found in his mouth. When he was abused, he did not return abuse. When he suffered, he did not threaten, but he entrusted himself to the one who judges justly. He himself bore our sins in his body on the cross, so that, free from sins, we might live for righteousness. By his wounds you have been healed. For you were going astray like sheep, but now you have returned to the shepherd and guardian of your souls. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
I can stay seated while I share a few words on this First Peter reading. So in year A of our lectionary, during the Easter season, we hear from First Peter. And many of the readings are wonderful. And then there's today's reading. So it has been my experience that when this passage is read in worship, some people can't hear the gospel because the message of this reading hurts too much. So I have to comment. Some Bible verses, I think, shouldn't be read aloud in worship anymore. And maybe this is one of them. So the lectionary committee leaves out the verse just before this reading, which is, "Slaves, accept the authority of your masters with all deference, not only those who are kind and gentle, but also those who are sharp, harsh." Where's the good news there? In the time of the writing of this letter, there were new Christians who were slaves in pagan households, and they were being harassed for their beliefs. So verse 18 is an important detail. First Peter attempts a pastoral word to those believers, making a distinction between suffering for a just cause and suffering for an unjust cause. The text teases a qualified sanction for suffering under certain circumstances. Now we can talk about that part more, but nowhere does it suggest that suffering is a legitimate condition for those who are abused, coerced, or oppressed. Nowhere does it suggest a stoic tolerance for violence against anyone. Nowhere does it suggest that God's name be invoked as the hand strikes, or the belt comes out, or the vestments come off. Today's reading from 1 Peter has been used, no, misused, by far too many people in the church through the centuries to justify abuse of all kinds, to keep some people down. That's wrong. Period. Let me say that again a bit differently. It is not God's will for anyone to be beaten. Spousal abuse, bullying of any kind, is not God's will. Hurting others in any way, physically, sexually, emotionally, spiritually, because one is able to, is not okay. You may not use the Bible to beat up on any of God's children. No ifs, ands, or buts. If you have been hurt by someone who loves you, there is help available, and I will help you find it. Now, I'm not talking about the normal ups and downs in relationships. We all hurt occasionally. We all hurt the ones we love occasionally, unintentionally. But systematic and cyclic name-calling, belittling, hitting or punching is not God's will. At school, at work, in the armed services, or in church. And I had more here, but I think I'll leave it there for today. I think that's enough. I can never hear that reading and not comment on it. Here we go. Please stand for the gospel. According to St. John.
Glory to you, O Lord.
Jesus said, "Very truly I tell you, anyone who does not enter the sheepfold by the gate, but climbs in by another way, is a thief and a bandit. The one who enters by the gate is the shepherd of the sheep. The gatekeeper opens the gate for him, and the sheep hear his voice. He calls his own sheep by name, and leads them out. When he has brought out all his own, he goes ahead of them, and the sheep will follow him because they know his voice. They will not follow a stranger, but will run away from him because they do not know the voice of strangers." Jesus used this figure of speech with them, but they did not understand what he was saying to them. So again, Jesus said to them, "Very truly I tell you, I am the gate for the sheep. All who came before me are thieves and bandits, but the sheep did not listen to them. I am the gate. Whoever enters by me will be saved, and will come in and go out and find pasture. The thief comes only to steal and kill and destroy. I came that they may have life and have it abundantly." The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, O Christ.
Grace and peace to you from God our Creator and our Lord and Savior Jesus the Christ. Amen. A friend of mine was coming out of church one day, and the preacher was standing at the door, as she always is, to shake hands. She grabbed my friend by the hand and pulled him aside. The pastor said to him, "You need to join the army of the Lord." My friend replied, "I'm already in the army of the Lord, Pastor." The pastor asked, "How come I don't see you except at Christmas and Easter?" He whispered back, "Because I'm in the Secret Service." Yeah. Psalm 23, so familiar, heard so often at bedsides of the dying, and then again at funerals. In this well-known psalm, the psalmist reminds us who the Lord is, what the Lord does, and who we actually are. The psalmist is likely under pressure. We do not know with certainty what that pressure is, but we have some clues. She calls out, "The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want." Perhaps he is lacking enough to eat and drink, enough safety and shelter, enough money to pay for what is necessary, like too many in our community and across the country. After saying that he is led to still waters, and his soul is restored, the psalmist continues, "Even though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death," there is, perhaps, the heaviest pressure of all, the unknown final journey of facing our own death. Immediately after that, we hear, "Shall fear no evil, for you are with me. Your rod and your staff, they comfort me." Comfort. Yet comfort in this psalm doesn't mean what we normally associate with the word. When we think of comfort, we are apt to think of a dear friend or family member gently consoling us, a sort of there thing. No, look again. A rod, and a staff, a big stick. We may recall the proverbial saying, spare the rod and spoil the child, a proverb used in support of harsh or corporal punishment. Think about it for a minute. You don't stroke somebody gently with a big stick. You prod with a stick. A shepherd uses his staff to prod and push the sheep to keep them going where they're supposed to go and prevent them from danger, from falling off a cliff. It's important to keep in mind that the shepherd doesn't beat the sheep. And this is true of the good shepherd. He doesn't beat or punish us. He disciplines us by reminding us always of God's care, by showing us green pastures and still waters, restoring our souls. The word comfort here is used with an old meaning that modern English has forgotten, come with, and fortis, strong, to strengthen, to make strong, not to stroke gently, but to push forward toward a destination, to empower in order to flourish. I remember a friend sharing a story of how he was crying in school, maybe in second grade. The teacher spoke firmly to him, stop right now. And he did, whispering to himself about how mean she was. Later she called him aside and explained, if I had spoken very gently to you, you would have cried harder and found it harder to stop yourself. I wasn't trying to be sharp or mean. I only wanted to help you strengthen yourself. The teacher was disciplining, not punishing or abusing. There's an important difference. Of course, admonishing a child or adults to stop right now is proper in some situations and not in others. We need to get tears out on occasion. We've learned how harmful it can be to teach boys not to cry. And yet, in the midst of pressures, even the valley of the shadow of death, the Good Shepherd prepares a table before us in the presence of enemies. We are anointed with oil, and our cups run over. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow you all the days of your life, and you will dwell in the house of the Lord forever. Amen.
Thank you. our faith. We believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being of the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven. By the power of the Holy Spirit, he became incarnate from the Virgin Mary and was made man. For our sake, he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day, he rose again, in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven, and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son. With the Father and the Son, he is worshipped and glorified. He has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy Catholic and Apostolic Church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen.
United in the hope and joy of the resurrection, let us pray for the church, the world, and all in need. You are the shepherd who gathers us in your mighty and loving arms. Help your church to listen for your voice, especially when the voices of sin, idolatry, and oppression threaten to overpower us. Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great.
The green pastures, still waters, and dark valleys of this earth all belong to you, O Lord. Sustain your creation with a love that is both mighty and just. Where there is destruction, bring healing. Where there is desolation, bring abundance. Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great.
You proclaim shepherding love, comfort, and protection for all people and all of creation. Direct leaders in our own time to learn from your example and instruction. Give them servant hearts that they generously seek the good of all. Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great.
You journey with us wherever our paths may lead. We pray for those feeling overwhelmed by anxiety or depression or suffering in any ways. Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great.
You are the sheep gate that gives safety to your beloved flocks. Provide protection for refugees, victims of domestic violence, those who are imprisoned, and all people who are vulnerable to violence and mistreatment. Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great.
Gracious God, we continue to pray for the people of Ukraine suffering bombings. We pray for the people in our own country who are suffering from floods or potential floods, tornadoes, all kinds of natural disasters. Comfort them with your presence and help them, help us, help them to heal. Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great.
You call your sheep by name and lead them through the valley of death. We give you thanks for those who have died and now dwell in your house forever, especially for those we name in our hearts or out loud. Be with those who mourn and give them hope in the promise of resurrection. Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great.
Rejoicing in the victory of Christ's resurrection, we lift our prayers and praise to you, Almighty and Eternal God, through Jesus Christ, our risen Lord.
Amen.
The peace of Christ be with you always.
And also with you.
Remember us in your kingdom and teach us to pray.
Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. Save us from the time of trial and deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen.
The God of all who raised Jesus from the dead, bless you by the power of the Holy Spirit to live in the new creation.
Amen.
Thank you.
and peace serve the risen one.
Thanks be to God.